Welcome to today's teaching point where we'll be talking about the DNA cell cycle analysis. Now, why is cell cycle analysis important? Well, let's briefly review how the cell cycle works. Cells start in a G1 phase or a resting phase. After some signal, they move into a synthesis phase where they're synthesizing their DNA to get to the double the DNA concentration, where they end up in what's called the G2 or the gap 2 phase. And again, they wait in this period until they get another signal where they go through mitosis and cell division, and then back into the G1 phase. Now we can analyze this using DNA binding dyes and generate these histograms to analyze our cell cycle analysis. This peak here is our G1 peak. We have a synthesis peak in this region here, and then of course our G2 and M peak. We can't easily resolve the G2M, but we'll talk about ways to do that later. DNA binding dyes are cell concentration dependent, so you need to optimize this and you have to have a saturating concentration. Your DNA structure can impact the binding. The cell state can also impact your signal. Nicked DNA stains better, as well as during apoptosis, there's an increase in DNA degradation, which will result in a sub G1 peak. DNA dyes also can bind to different locations. And just to highlight this, is this image from the Thermo Fisher website showing the idea that we have intercalators, major and minor groove binders, we have external binders, all of which have different characteristics when used for cell cycle analysis. Why do we do one-dimensional cell cycle analysis? Well, in one case, we're looking at what's called the DNA index. The DNA index is a ratio of some experimental sample to some known control. If the two samples have a ratio of 1, then we have a normal diploid cell. Between 0.85 and about 1.5, we can have an aneuploid population. Aneuploid populations are very interesting for those studying cancer. We can also measure things like hypo or hyperdiploid. If we have a ratio about 1.9 to 2.1, this is usually our the 1.9 to 2.1 is typically our G2M phase, but of course can represent tetraploid populations. And then of course we can have multiple peaks if we have a multiploid or polyploid population. This is polyploidy is normal in certain developmental processes, such as in plants and in. When doing one parameter cell cycle analysis, it's important to add a control of known DNA concentrations such as CENs or TENs. And this will help you standardize your assay and give you a good way to characterize your populations of interest. DNA histogram did not resolve the S phase very well. So how can we do that? Well, we can move into a second dimension. We can use thymidine analogs like BRDU and EDU, which are actively incorporated into synthesizing DNA. In the case of BRDU, we detect this via an antibody, which requires us to break the DNA, fragment the DNA a bit. And here is an example of BRDU versus 70 AD. Here is our G0, G1 peak. Our BRDU positive sample here shows our S phase very nicely. And then we get to our G2M peak. If we look at the same results by EDU, we see the similar pattern shown here. G0, G1, S phase, G2M. How to resolve the G2M phase? Well, we take advantage of the fact that the histone H3 is phosphorylated at the 80 during mitosis. Here's your histogram again. Here is your histogram. We cannot resolve the G2M. But if we look at a plot of DNA content versus phospho-H3, we can see very nice population rising out of the G2M phase. Now, if we take a look at these populations or we use this phosphorylated histone H3 under confocal microscope, we're able to detect its signal here at prophase, prometaphase, metaphase, and of course it's gone by anaphase. The final portion of the cell cycle analysis is the ability to detect the G0 and the G1 phase. Cells in the G0 phase are quiescent, and they decrease the RNA content in this phase. Cells in G1, which are waiting for the proliferation signals, they also contain normal amounts of RNA. Turns out Peronin Y will bind to both DNA and RNA, while HERX33342 binds to DNA only. So we can outcompete the Peronin Y DNA binding if we combine these two dyes together. The nice thing about this is both of these dyes can be used on living cells and therefore can be used to sort the G0 from G1 peak if you're looking to characterize quiescent from active cells. Here is our histogram again showing the G0, G1 peak we cannot resolve. But if we look at Peronin Y versus Herxt, we can now resolve the G0 and G1 peak based upon the RNA content. In summary, cell cycle analysis by flow cytometry can identify all the different phases of the cell cycle based upon the dyes and combination of dyes that are used. Single parameter analysis provides us for DNA index, identifying normal from abnormal cells. It's a very good way to test if a drug of interest may be causing the cells to pause at a given cell cycle state. If we want to resolve the S phase, we use thymidine analogs like BRDU and EDU, which are incorporated into the synthesizing DNA and then can be detected either using an antibody or the Click-It kit. The M phase can be resolved using phosphohistone H3. So now we're able to resolve M phase, S phase, and that leaves us with the G1, G0 phase. And the G1, G0 phase are resolved using peronin Y and HERX33342. Peronin Y preferentially binds to DNA and RNA, while HERXT will outcompete peronin Y for the DNA binding, allowing us to look at RNA content and identify the G0 from the G1 peak. Of course, the beauty of this technique and all techniques in flow cytometry is that it can be combined with phenotyping markers to completely characterize how the cell cycle is progressing in a mixed population.